Back, X-Wing fans, for round three of the original trilogy. We have two very interesting lists. We have Cam Murray flying as Rebels with Rey and Kian, and Aaron, who is a longtime PTL member, flying a very unique Imperial list with Karner Jax, Deathfire, Scimitar Squadron, two Scimitar Squadron pilots. So just to hop into the lists a little bit, Cam is flying Rey with VI, Kanan, Finn, Crane, smuggling compartment, countermeasures, and I would imagine the new title. And Kian Farlander, who's B-Wing, with stay on target, advanced sensors, navigator, and title.
Ooh, I like that.
And then Aaron is flying Karner Jax with PTL, thrusters, twin ion Mark II, title, Deathfighter with extra munitions, unguided rockets, prox mines, lightweight frame, Scimitar pilot with unguided rockets, seismic charge, lightweight frame, and then another Scimitar pilot flying flechette torpedoes, an unguided rocket, and long-range scanners. So a very unique smattering of upgrades that I can see they do a little bit of everything. So rocks look like they're the big rocks, generally kind of setting up in your classic pinwheel formation in the middle of the board.
Mm-hmm.
And I've got my co-announcer back, Mike.
Hello.
This is really interesting. So standard Rey, we saw this earlier today. Very similar. Actually, it's exactly the same as the one we saw in round one.
Yep.
This Kian Farlander. Kian's one of my favorite ships. I haven't played around with the B-Wings in a long time. But stay on target Kian is so much fun to fly. Especially with advanced sensors, you get to go wherever the hell you want to go. And he's even thrown Navigator on there, which means he can definitely go wherever the heck he wants to go.
That is a fantastic upgrade.
Right. Because Navigator lets you change the speed, and then stay on target lets you change the thing. So
you are familiar in that in one of your X-Wing builds, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah. Well, stay on target's one of, I think... we're just raffling off some ships here. So where was it? Stay on target, I think, is a really underappreciated upgrade. It gives you so much flexibility in where you want to move, where you're going to move. I love it on Kian. I love it on Nien Nub. Nien Nub with BB-8 and stay on target,
yep,
just goes wherever the heck you want.
Which is so much fun.
I calculated it out. It's something like 250 possible final positions.
Wonderful.
Right? Because with BB, you on Nien Nub, you dial in the three straight.
You probably have vector thrusters, so you can barrel roll.
Well, BB-8.
Oh, yeah,
right?
BB-8. Yeah. There we
go. So you dial in the three straight. You can then choose to BB-8 or not, right? Barrel roll or not, which is... so that's left or right or in the same. Stay where you are. So that's three times three, if you count the barrel rolls as, like, back or forth.
Yep.
Being different positions as well. And then times seven, because there's seven different three-speed maneuvers, right?
That's
then
crazy.
Times another three, because you can choose to barrel, boost or not. Actually,
right.
Four, right? Because you can stay where you are or boost with pattern analyzer, right? So basically, Nien Nub with stay on target and BB-8 can go anywhere.
Which is fun.
Which is so much fun. But you're only doing it at PS7, right? So, you can tear apart low PS ships, but high PS ships you have to be more careful with. Anywho, same thing with Kian Farlander, PS7. So which is why I would normally run him with Intel Agent, not Navigator, and just dial in the 2K all the time.
Yep.
Right? Those two speeds give you more than enough options, I think, to get your red maneuver, get the stress, and then as long as you have your shot, But the reason for having intel agent is if you come across ships that are higher PS than you, you want to know where they're going.
AKA Karnor.
Sorry? AKA Karnor. Karnor. So this Kian's going to have trouble getting Karnor locked down. A intel agent Kian would at least know where Karnor's going and would know if he wants to turn around or this or that. So it's trickier. That being said, you do have PS 10 or 8 to cover
right.
you, so
that's fine.
Now,
which is a bit of a tough thing because Karnor, as you know, freezes those tokens. But in something like Ray,
it's not expertise Ray though. It's
so it is a little different.
It is a little different. The one we had before was expertise. This one's veteran instincts, which means
he does need the token a little more than you typically would with an expertise.
Uh huh.
I mean, he'll still get the rerolls, which is nice. So he's a little more okay with bumping and maybe not having a token as some of the others.
Now, what's funny is you could totally fit expertise here if you bumped down Navigator to Intel Agent.
Right.
Right? That would do the trick, right? To fit, because he's got two extra points, Veteran Instincts is one, you take that off, put on expertise, then you need one more point. Navigator's two, I think?
Yes, I think so.
So you bump it down to one, because Intel Agent is one, and then you're set.
Yeah, on something like Ray to boost up to 10, it's more or less just a counter against Soon Tier.
Yeah, for sure. But again, if you've got Intel Agent on one of your ships, then it helps against the PS issue. It's not perfect, but it helps.
Yeah, this will be an interesting matchup. Aaron is a very, very squirrely pilot. Is out of jank as this looks on the screen. This is the type of list that Aaron legitimately flies a lot of the time. He flies odd combinations of ships.
And does well with them, too.
Very.
He always surprises me with his builds. And I think because Aaron's the kind of guy who...
likes something different.
Yeah, he likes stuff different. He actively finds... the current meta frustrating, I feel like.
He does.
Like, he doesn't like Jump Masters, and I'm pretty sure he...
He's a little upset that Imperials are hit so hard. Like, I mean, yeah. He is a big Imperial player, mm-hmm. and they're in a tough spot.
I think, I really think if they ever nerf the Jump Master, Imperials might see a bit of a resurgence, but that's a ways out. We'll see. Who knows? That said... he actively tries to make new lists that challenge the meta
yep.
specifically.
And he's the type of person that will build a hard counter list.
Yeah, hard counter
list.
You'll
go in and you'll just be like, oh, my list is not going to beat that.
Or even like a hard counter list or lists that are specifically just like, I'm going to do something that is just not meta.
Right.
Right? Because he likes surprising people.
And that's a very prototype Toronto list.
Oh, yeah, for
type
sure.
mentality. But you're right. I mean, you can fly some really great tier one lists. And every once in a while, you can just come up against people that fly such an odd list that you just can't ever plan
yep.
against it.
Yep.
You'll have no reps against it. And you kind of have to either figure out how to beat it on the fly or you're going to have a rough time.
Yep. and it's funny that you say that's a prototype Toronto... attitude. Aaron was actually the originator of the Prototype Toronto League. And so for those of you just tuning in, Stephen and I and a bunch of the local players here all participate in the Prototype Toronto League, which is a league that runs here at various gaming stores in Toronto. And the way it works is you fly 7 matches against different opponents over the course of each season,
yep.
which will be about 2 months long. And the key is that you are not allowed using the same named pilot twice in any of those matches. So, for example, we've got Karnor and Deathfire here with Aaron. He wouldn't be able to use those same ships in another match in the league.
Right.
The idea being... that we would then be trying different lists, new meta lists, things like that.
And not only do you have that, after the end of those 7 weeks, if you do make the top 8, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, top 8.
You then have to continue on and you do not get your pilots refreshed.
No.
So depending on what you fly, you can be scraping the bottom of the barrel going into the top eight.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, there are enough good pilots out there that we just rolled five dice. Oh, that was Karner.
Yeah.
I think that was Ray shooting Karner.
Obstructed
range three.
That was
Karner is shooting Kian at obstructed range two. That's two hits.
Oh, that was Reyes shooting first. That was Reyes shooting into Karner.
Yeah. And
there's damage.
One of eight.
The thing that's interesting I find about B-Wings, and you don't really see them do it as much in the game anymore, is the B-Wings are shield heavy.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of times, a lot of the new ships coming out will have
more
high
hull.
Hit points, but they'll still have fairly minimal shields.
Yeah, I think, I'm trying to think of how many ships have more shields than hull, and I think the B-Wing is the only one.
Yeah. No, Y-Wing has more hull.
Yeah. E-Wing? Is E-Wing three hull, two shields, or three shields, two hull? I think the E-Wing might be. Let's find out. E-Wing. Two hull, three shields, yeah. E-Wing and the B-Wing are the only ones I can think of. Which is interesting.
Is our chat frozen? Oh, okay. Very quiet crowd.
Do remember, guys, if you have any questions or comments, feel free to chat away.
Okay, that's fine then. I'm like, wow, the last one was at 105.
We do like your comments. They give us things to talk about because, you know, there's only so much whiffing we can do on. hello. Where are we here? Now, which bomber's which? 2, 3, 4. Deathfire is number two.
Deathfire's.
Yeah.
Closest to the board edge.
Yep. Rocks mines.
We will not do more jump masters. We need no more jump
masters. No more jump masters. And in fact, there are no scum in this tournament at all.
Which is the proper way to run a tournament.
I mean, I only fly rebels and scum, and I enjoy flying scum, some of my scum stuff, but I actually don't own a jump master yet.
For shame.
For shame, apparently.
For shame.
And I'm kind of okay with that. I'm kind of an Aaron type.
Yes, you are.
In that I like flying random things that are new and different and not necessarily meta heavy.
Yeah, you know, scum is getting a lot of love lately. I can certainly see why people fly them.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they've got a lot of really interesting ships.
And a lot of them have been neat.
The abilities are neat. The ship's abilities are good. The ships themselves are good.
I mean, the problem is just the Jumpmaster, right? That's it.
Yeah.
That is the thing that really kind of throws the whole meta off. So I was saying this earlier off mic, but I would not be surprised if the Jumpmaster got a nerf soon.
Scum crew is very good.
Yeah, a lot of the scum crew.
Scum in general, they've gotten a lot of expansions recently that seem to put them ahead on the power curve.
I don't necessarily know if the crew is unbalancing, but there are a lot of good crew options for scum, that's for sure.
Right, like if you have 1 to 2 points with scum and you have crew slot open,
you can do a lot
of different things.
You feel it. All right, what are we waiting for here? Looks like we're still waiting for a dial for number two, Deathfire. What's Deathfire's ability? I always forget that. Let's look that up. I was looking that up.
He can go out the front, right?
Is he the out the front guy? Bomber. TIE Bomber.
When you reveal your maneuver dial or after you perform an action, you may perform a bomb.
Card
action as a free action.
So he turns... So The YT-2400 in on Tatooine is there only in the special edition. And it's only like a 2-second shot. You see it in the background flying away. So we have decided for the rules for this tournament, special edition does not count for this tournament. They have to have been in the original movies, those ships.
And to be clear, it is the ship,
not the pilot. Which is why we've got Rey here. I mean, a lot of the pilots aren't necessarily canon in the...
nice. There's some advanced sensor shenanigans.
Yeah, advanced sensor shenanigans on B-Wings. I love that. Barrel roll hard one. That was actually a well-placed hard one.
Yes, it was.
I would have actually considered just doing it and then barrel rolling back here. Rob, we decided that the ship had to be in the movie, not the pilot. You never see the Jumpmaster, nor do you see the Aggressor in the movies, so no good. And that would really just leave only those two ships available to Scum if we did that anyways. And so we've decided that we've just got a Imperials and Rebels only, just to keep it simple, just to keep it classic
right.
Star Wars.
I mean, more or less, like, everybody knows Scum is very good.
Yeah.
It's really just an idea to get ships that you don't see commonly played back into the meta. You know, back to give people some time to play ships that really just aren't as competitive now as they used to be.
Yeah.
As well as having some thematic fun.
All right. What is that? Is that a hard two from Ray? That's gonna... Oh, wow.
No, Cam's...
So, moved by Cam.
Cam Murray is a very, very experienced Chewie Miranda player.
Oh, okay.
So he is so familiar with flying the Falcon.
Right, right.
So it does not surprise me that he can maneuver that in and out of the rocks.
Mm-hmm.
No problem.
Well placed.
The amount of reps he has is insane.
Thing is, he's in this kill box here for...
Aaron's put him in a nice spot.
Yeah, and he's got all those rockets who are just going to come flying.
And he can chase them, too. Like, he's in a... Rey, yep, I agree. Rey does see a lot of play.
I haven't seen her too much lately, but... rules for what exactly, David?
The tournament in general?
The tournament or the game?
Let's see, I can pull them up, though.
Maybe we could get someone to copy and paste from the Facebook event into the chat here.
And by someone, we mean not us.
Yeah, well, we don't have access to the chat right now, or... Phil over here, our VTT live. Sorry?
Yeah, is there a way you can copy and paste the rules from the Facebook event into the chat?
Yeah, mostly just the ship list and whatever.
Yeah, so we'll
again, it's everything from the original trilogy movies. So TIE, interceptors, bombers, advanced, Lambda shuttle, fire spray, versus the Rebels YT 1300, A-Wing, B-Wing, X-Wing, Y-Wing. I think that's about it.
Yeah, yeah. So I've got the rules up from me. So the ships you're allowed to fly for Rebels, YT-1300, T-65, A-Wing, B-Wing, Y-Wing. Imps have TIE Fighter, TIE Advanced, TIE Interceptor, TIE Bomber, Lambda, Fire Spray. Was there not a Docking Bay 416 article? There may have been, yeah.
I think when we did the first one a few months ago, someone wrote an article about it. I could be wrong.
The really only card banned is the TLT card.
Yeah. And TLT is just in... it's a bit too destabilizing to the old meta, or the old list of ships. Like, TLT would take...
B-Wing would be ripped off the board so fast.
Well, the thing is, though, you never actually have that happen because it's always Imperial versus Rebels, and Imperial don't have...
Right.
These ships don't have... access to TLTs. We are getting someone to copy and paste the list into the chat.
always saw flechette torpedoes go off, I think, is what just happened.
Kian took some flechettes.
Yep.
Interesting. Although, yeah, pre-stressing Kian is no good.
Yeah, that's an interesting move.
Yeah, unguided rockets are great against countermeasures. For sure.
And the thing we have here, obviously, is right now Cam is more or less in a spot where he's kind of chasing Karnar, which is a little rough now, given that the Falcon can turn around right away. And we might see a bank, like a sloop, coming up.
Oh, just looks like the damage decks are coming out here. I love how no scum was in caps.
Yeah, just the stress.
Yeah,
no
scum. No scum. No, none allowed. None at all allowed.
And if anything, if I had to guess on the YT2400 comment,
yeah,
our meta, people like their dash.
Oh, I love dash. Dash and is one of my favorite chips.
If you were allowed to have dash, you would just see a lot of dash.
A lot of dash. All right.
We've got dials down.
Yep.
Oh, no, Karnar is going to set his. His isn't down yet.
They've been taking their time setting their dials. Not necessarily a bad thing. All right.
No, if I had to guess, I think Aaron's probably just going to too hard around this rock and keep on going. Are any Imperials? Yes, the Lambda has
Lambda
a
is,
cannon.
Yeah. Yep. Other than that, the Defender. But the Defender is not allowed in this particular tournament.
Right.
I think those are the only two cannons.
Right, yeah. Defenders aren't valid.
For this tournament, just in general, those are the only two. Actually, no, the Fire Spray has a cannon slot as well.
Oh, yeah, there we go.
Yeah. Fire Spray and the Lambda both have cannon slots.
I actually think somebody is running a tractor beam on their shuttle today.
Really?
Yes,
amazing.
I believe Joe Silva's list, his Imperial list, is running it.
That sounds like something Joe would do. All right, so what are we going to get here? And now, if I were Aaron, I'd probably sloop. I'm betting he's going to do a bank to the right.
Yep. I think he needs to get that arc refacing those defenders.
Yeah, bombers, you mean?
Yeah, facing his bombers.
What is he doing? Well, he couldn't do a red because he was stressed.
He's going to do.
With
the B-wing, and now he's clear, so now I'll be able to advance sensor around that. Again?
Nick, we did just have an Imperial Fire Spray in the previous round.
Yeah, we saw
and you might
Cat
actually
Scarlet.
See, I think we actually have a few going on today just because of the nature of the tournament.
Yes, there are Imperial Fire Sprays, though. A few people.
Lockjaw, no. You cannot, in tournaments, use... use epic based ships as obstacles.
Now, would somebody have allowed it in this tournament? I actually don't know. If somebody asked the question.
No.
Awesome.
Oh, yeah, sure. Oh, yeah,
sure.
Fair enough.
Oh,
fair, right,
sense.
Yes.
Okay. So,
question, which chat do we have here? Both? Oh, perfect. That's nice. We can?
Wow.
There'll be a little Twitch symbol beside some, and there'll be, that's a YouTube symbol.
Oh.
There'll be a little purple Twitch symbol.
Oh.
Good to know. interesting. I would have considered slooping the other way, as to get all three in arc, but here we are. So, Ray's got a range 3 shot, it looks like, through the rock at bomber number 3.
Yep. I'd fire on number 2 if he's got him in range.
Mm-hmm.
The one way out. and hope you can potentially just block number three the next round.
Deathfire? I would, you know what? I would just go after number three.
Yeah.
Although,
No, I mean, three's got lightweight frames, which doesn't actually do a lot in this game. I don't know.
Sorry?
I'd pick one and just shoot at this point. I don't know if there's a great...
They both got lightweight frames. I'm wondering is that Proxmine going to be a problem? Two crits.
That's a nice thing to say.
Oh, wow. Three crits and a hit.
Ouch. Oh, wow. So he took... Did he have a focus? So he took one.
Looks like he took a crit. That looks like a... I can't read it.
I can't see it either.
Yeah, they need to put it in the tray. What is that? Is that a direct hit?
Thrust control fire.
Thrust control fire. Yep. Yeah, thrust control fire. So receive one stress token, flip the card down. And you can see, took the stress token, flip the card down.
What's going on here? Why are they... Oh, just to measure range.
He's in.
Range three, obstructed, though. You've got to go closest point.
Yes.
Although they were checking, actually, an arc.
Yeah. Yep, they were checking
arc. I still think it's obstructed. As good as it gets for a bomber.
Why not?
Yeah. But, I mean, you're going up against Ray, who's got three dice and two free rerolls.
No.
And actually, adding could actually have up to four dice in that situation because of Finn. He really just has not done anything worthwhile with Kian, though, which is really unfortunate.
No. Scavenger Crane?
No, I think they were talking about tournament levels.
Oh, for SC and above, only the 12. Oh, Store Champ.
Store Champs, yeah. Store Champs and above, yeah. Yeah, and I honestly don't... I can't imagine any smaller tournament actually allowing a Sea Rock or anything, or a Rebel Transport to be used as debris or an obstacle.
If somebody let me do that, I would take a Seismic Torp just to rip that thing off the table.
Yeah, and just blow it off the table.
It would be worth it every single time.
Because would it count as an obstacle?
It counts as an asteroid.
Yeah, right? So I guess I would totally just... Yeah, you put it right in the middle. It takes up so much space, and then you Seismic Torp it, and something's going to be near it.
Oh,
right?
Even if you use your own. You can set it up in front and then walk straight down the board, pop it when you need to.
Yep.
Be like, middle of the board's open.
Yep.
Oh, that would be so much fun.
Ooh, Kian is in such bad shape.
He's
and
got
this
an advanced
is,
sensor.
Yeah, but I mean, this is the thing, though. This Kian should be behind those bombers, just tearing them apart.
You're not allowed to for an actual legal tournament. You can use them in a casual game. Legal tournaments, you're not allowed to.
Yeah, I've never seen it allowed in a large tournament. I don't know if it's even allowed at like a game night kit tournament. That might be TO choice. Oh, can't be destroyed with. Oh, that's a shame.
That's sad. You're still not allowed to take them at a store champ or above.
Yeah, I
would. Might be able to on a game kit, but it'd be up to the store.
Yeah, that'd be kind of fun. I don't know. I've never actually flown one with one of those as an obstacle. Now, see, yeah, Kian here is in the wrong place, in my opinion. Kian should be, I don't know, I
well, the one thing
Kian should be endeavoring to get behind these bombers, right?
Is that...
Because once he's behind them, he can just do whatever the heck he wants to them, right?
You've also got the problem now that Kian, sooner or later, unless he keeps trying to run after Karnor, and only in a two-ship list, this is going to probably be a mistake. Karnor is going to start coming back around.
Yeah, he shouldn't be running after Karnor here. He should be tearing apart the bombers with Kian, because that's what Kian's good at, arc dodging lower PS ships, right?
Right.
Now, none of these bombers have taken much in the way of damage.
No. No, Aaron's played this extremely well.
So here's what I would do with Kian. I probably dialed in the 2K, right?
Yep.
I would barrel roll towards bomber number four, and then change it to a hard two. So I'm staring bomber number four right in the face, right? And then, oh no, now bomber number four is in a much better position. That's problematic.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? I might still do it. Barrel roll, hard two, so I just arc dodged all three of the bombers.
Yeah.
Then I don't get shot, and then next turn I could come around and just start getting them from behind. Right? But no, he's still...
Right, yeah, I mean, that's, Nick, that's pretty much sort of the comment. I like the sort of turning, not a list of ships the TO hates, but the thematic restrictions. That's really what this is all about.
Yeah.
It's honestly just a tournament for a lot of people to bring back stuff that they don't get to fly anymore.
Yeah.
And to flex, like, their creativity.
Yeah. Try something new. See, and this is where I think he's making a mistake with Kian. He's chasing Karnor with him. I would just let Ray take care of Karnor with the turret, right? And
yeah.
Yeah, like, I mean,
would agree.
So Robert Monroe is saying that his guess is if the board state does not change radically in the next two turns, we're looking at an Imperial victory. I would say so too. I think Cam's made a huge mistake with Kian, where he's put Kian.
Well, I think these three, so the three bombers right now can take Ray.
Well, Ray hasn't moved yet.
I know. Well,
but Ray's
going to go forward somewhere and sloop, or just try to bug out and sloop down and try to go back around.
No, that's probably going to be a sloop, so he's got a shot at bomber number four, maybe number three. But Kian should really be over past these bombers so that he can just start harassing them from behind.
Right.
Right? That's the thing. That's what you have to do with Kian. Right? It's odd to think of a B-Wing like this, but Kian Farlander with Stay on Target is an arc dodger. Right? That's what he's got to be. And he's actually surprisingly good at it with advanced sensors and the 2K. He can really get in there, dodge arcs, and have range one shots. Right? Leaving him out like this is... Jousting with him is just the wrong choice. I don't think he's actually used Stay on Target once.
No.
Which is... you're really just not playing to Kian's strengths here.
Yeah, it's range one.
So that's going to be a range one shot from Ray on to...
Scimitar Squadron Pilot.
No, shoot the one you've already shot, right? Why not shoot number four, who's range two?
I think I would take range two and try to...
I would take range two and just try to push out that extra damage.
Awesome.
He's hoping Deathfire's in range. I prefer a looser version of this. Okay, so Kirk here has said he prefers a looser version that includes ships shown in any movies, including Force Awakens and Rogue One. So that is the T-70s and Strikers. TIE FOs, I guess, and that's about it.
You could bring the ARC back in.
Oh, the ARCs, well, he said Rogue One and Force Awakens, not the prequels. The ARCs only in the prequels. Ray just landed a whole bunch of damage into, so that's five hits, or so three hits, two crits, into,
ouch.
Which one here? Number three, bomber number three, who taking two hits and two crits. That is, can't see that there. Nope, no idea what that is. Okay.
Direct hit.
And something else. What's
that?
So that
thing should be on one hull then.
That's probably a major hull breach. Yeah. But now Ray's gonna eat a whole bunch of shots.
Oh yeah.
Is Deathfire, I think they're all in her arc though, which means she gets the rerolls and okay, what's Nick saying about triple T-70s here? Don't really have a place in... Oh. That the triple T-70s work in the unrestricted meta? Good question.
Well, I mean, like, it's not that they can't, but on a large scale, no, they don't. I mean, of course, you have one-offs and outliers and everything, but from a large sample size, no.
Right, right. As someone who loves triple T-70s, I just don't think they're perfect in a in the current unrestricted meta. So number four, so he did take the shot at number four, the one who's already damaged. He's down to one hull. Now Ray's taking a bunch of shots. Karnar's got nothing, so I think we're back at the end of the turn here.
Yeah, and to clarify, let's exclude Poe from that on competitive T70s, because Poe is pretty good.
Poe is solid.
Intensity Poe, we're starting to see a little bit more. He's good.
Yeah, I'm curious to see what how that plays out. I haven't gotten an intensity yet, either.
Yeah, Poe with intensity and Dash. It's a nice build.
Or Ray.
Yep.
And then, so you don't use, do you use R2-D2 in that build?
The concept of...
Eras. Oh, so Nick's saying, yeah, the concept of eras came in Force Awakens, because there were different eras, I guess.
Yeah, I agree. And you're right, you could.
So you'd want to try a, looks like Nick's saying he would want to try a Resistance / First Order...
match?
Tournament. Which I guess it doesn't really give you that many options, though. It's the Upsilon and... No,
strikers.
Not even Strikers. Because Strikers aren't First Order.
Yeah. The triple system. Yes.
So, Kirk, that's actually my list. Kirk's here saying, my favorite list in X-Wing is a triple T-70 list that he first saw in the PTL Open. That's my list. I flew that. I flew that. I came up with that list primarily because I wanted to try just making a list with all three of the heroes of the Resistance pilots, Nien Nub, Snap Wexley, and Jess Pava, and using all the upgrades and so on from that.
It's a great list.
I've tweaked it a bunch. Eventually, I think actually someone suggested Stay on Target and BB-8 on Reddit somewhere. And I was just like, you know what? Perfect. Stay on Target and BB-8 on Nien Nub is fantastic. I was just saying how I enjoy Kian as an Arc Dodger, right? Like a surprising Arc Dodger. Nien Nub is definitely that PS7 Arc Dodger.
Yeah, it's also just a fun list to fly.
Oh, yeah. So much fun.
I mean, it's competitive, and it is... It's just a blast.
Yeah, it's fun to fly because you actually have to think about flying it. It's not just like move and shoot someone with a turret. You have to like dodge arcs. You have to really be careful, but you can get some really powerful shots out of these guys.
Yep.
So it's the key to that list, though, I think, is pattern analyzer. That's what really makes T-70s worth flying. Without that, they just don't have the action economy. And you're spending all your time trying to ignore or trying to avoid shots or whatever, and you're not getting the shots off as well as you can. But with pattern analyzer on snap, he can and PTL, he can get three actions a turn with no stress. Nien Nub can change his position and get either range one or a focus every turn.
Yeah, just a blast.
Sorry?
No. Yeah, and that's really the fun. So Kirk, the comment, I've had more fun flying the list than almost anything else I've tried in the last several months. I certainly found a point as I was playing X-Wing where you actually have to enjoy the lists you're flying.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, I mean, right now a very meta-heavy list is Fenn, Anuldra, and Dengar.
Right.
The list is boring as sin to fly.
See, he's not using stay on target at all. Where did he get that stress from? I'm so confused. Oh, maybe he did change it.
Prequel trilogy.
Arc Falcon? Is the Falcon in the prequel trilogy? TIE Fighters aren't in the prequel trilogy. The only ship in the prequel trilogy is the Arc.
Are we saying that
fighters? They don't show
are we,
up.
Are we including Rogue One, I guess, in the prequels?
Because it's more
it's before New Hope.
It's Rebellion era, though.
Yeah.
Okay, so does Rey hit that prox mine? So Deathfire here dropped a prox mine. Oh no!
Well, she hasn't hit it this round. She's gonna hit it next round.
Wow. No, not necessarily, because she could bank out and not go over it.
Oh, the Falcon has a cameo in episode 3.
Yeah, It's there in one shot in the background, same as the YT-2400 in the special editions.
Right.
I don't think it really counts. It's not. It's not the focus of.
Right.
The shit.
No, it's not.
Of the movie, you don't actually like
range
see
one?
It used. So Ray's taking range one shot.
Yeah, it's true. It would make the chassis fit.
Yeah. Anyways, as for the T70 list, I'm actually really glad people are enjoying that. It became kind of a thing after that video got posted on Reddit.
Yeah.
And that pleases me. It's something, I mean, I came up with just for fun, and it's really fun to fly, but it seems like a lot of people have gotten a lot of just joy out of flying that list.
Right.
So, you know, thanks for flying it, guys. I appreciate that.
On an Imperial side, I think one of the more fun lists to fly, if you haven't played around with it a lot, is an Intel agent on an Upsilon coordinating with an Inquisitor. Is
oh,
a
yeah.
blast. Like, the shenanigans you can do beginning
okay.
is...
Yep.
It's a lot of fun. And it feels AC and proper, like, flying
mm-hmm.
in the game.
Mm-hmm.
I would be okay with clone and droid era ships, so the comment, and that's why I'd like to see clone droid era ships get added to the game. I agree.
A lot
I'd
of
be
people,
okay with that.
I mean,
want Jar Jar Binks in the game.
The big problem is it would be hard to figure out exactly which ships go with which.
Well, yeah, technically the Jedi are now part of...
But are they of the Resistance? Like,
no.
Can you fly the Jedi with the... do you make new factions entirely, or do you...
Well, the Galactic Senate turned into the Empire.
Exactly,
so therefore,
right. So
the Jedi are Imperial ships?
Are Imperial ships?
I like that.
I mean, it doesn't make much sense. The way things change, right?
Yeah, which would be typically, at least in this type of tournament, so the comment that the fire spray's in there.
In the original... In the prequels?
Yeah, and you're right. For
yeah.
a very short amount of time. Could be on either faction. That would be fine.
I think a fourth faction would be trouble. I don't think... I don't know if it would really be good for the game.
I think FFG's already shown they have a hard time balancing it with three factions.
Yeah, balancing
I don't think a four would be
although,
a good idea.
You know, maybe it could be good because that would let them try a whole bunch of new ideas...
Maybe.
On a different faction, so instead of just giving those new ideas to Scum, say?
If I'm not mistaken, there was a playtesting group that tried to do droid ships.
Oh, yeah.
Like, FFG has kicked around the idea before in playtesting circles. And
I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised. But maybe they just want to avoid it for now. And especially because, like, all the new movies are coming out.
It happened long ago.
Yeah, I could see that being long ago. Now the idea is probably just off of the board entirely. Ooh, hello, Daniel from Paris.
That's fun.
We've got some people from all over the world watching, which is pretty awesome.
Same. I would like to see a Black Sun faction would be
as a sub faction.
An actual sub faction would be kind of neat.
Yeah. I mean, we do have a lot of Black Sun ships, though, right? And especially with Guns for Hire coming out, there's
yeah.
going to be more Black Sun ships, I believe is the plan.
I think it wouldn't be a terrible, like, it would at least be kind of a neat thematic idea to be able to hire bounty hunters as an Empire or Rebel faction for a certain amount of points or whatever you have to increase it to.
Yeah, yeah, that could be interesting, like a mod or an EPT or something that is, like, hired, whatever, you may take this ship. But that introduces balance issues, right? Like, if it's hard enough to balance it without cross-faction ships, then it's hard, then, I mean, I don't know if we'll see that happen. Anyways, getting back to the game, we kind of miss, we've been talking about theoretical ships and so on so much that we haven't really been paying attention here. Kian, it seems like Kian ate it from some unguided rockets, and so did one of the Scimitar squadrons. I just think that Kian was just in the wrong position most of the game. You really want to get him behind the enemy ships, and he never got even close, which is a shame. That leaves Rey to take on this whole list here. is not looking good. It's possible if there's some very good flying, but that Proxmine means that
Ray has to do a one hard onto a rock.
Not even a one hard. No, he can bank because.
Oh yeah, I guess I can't see where the nubs are.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure those nubs are.
And nubs do count on mines.
Oh, do they?
They do.
Oh yeah, that makes sense. But I'm pretty sure he could three bank or whatever easily enough. Or even hard three if he was expecting that 4K from the Scimitar Squadron. So if you hard three, blow that thing up before it gets a shot at you, and then Karner has no shot at you, and, you know, so that's not a terrible idea.
I think I would honestly, if I were Aaron at this point, just keep floating Karner around the edge and just try to move him out of arc.
Just to keep the points?
Keep the points. You don't really want to fight Ray in her arc.
True.
As an interceptor. I think it would be interesting to be able to hire out bounty hunters. I thought that was kind of a neat idea prior to even Scum becoming a faction themselves.
Yeah, yeah.
Being able to have...
Loose ships that could be hired by either side.
Yeah.
That'll be interesting, actually. I wonder if... That could be another interesting tournament format, actually.
Yeah.
Rebels versus Imperial, where you could choose to hire out Scum ships. Oh, you know what would be cool? You know what they did at the FFG Open? What was it? The
You're talking about the Coruscant Open.
The Coruscant
where
you Open.
Had a small pool of...
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So you made a 77-point ship, point list, and there were all these other mini lists that were like 23 to 28 points or whatever it was. Is that just a two bank? He escapes without going over the prox mine. Just barely. That's a shame for Aaron. But Ray makes it out. Problem is, Ray there. Oh, Ray pops countermeasures.
He's still going to eat a range one from Karner.
Yeah.
And now, actually, with that, Karner is now out of Ray's arc.
Mm hmm.
So, hello, auto thrusters.
Ooh,
Talon card would be neat.
I don't know much about Talon card.
So that's more of an EU type of thing in the original Thrawn trilogy.
Oh, okay.
And elsewhere, but would be very cool. I agree.
The thing is, we're not going to see many EU things happen anymore, I don't think. Maybe some, but they've just got so much material from the new movies, from Rebels, from the new books, and so on. Like, that's where Thane came from.
Yeah, it's where they also really built out the backstory behind, like, Snap Wexley and Nora.
I just finished that book last night, actually.
Pretty good.
The third one.
Yeah, it's pretty good.
Yeah, it's fun. So as I was saying, what would be an interesting...
Thrusters and then a focus?
Who's this? Who's shooting who here? That's Ray shooting Karner?
Oh, no, that was Ray shooting into number four. Oh,
yes,
so
yeah, that's definitely the choice. You kill number four.
Yeah, he didn't eat that bait.
So, Thrawn, we can pull stuff from the...
Rebels.
From the Rebels TV show and the new book, which is next on my reading list. So, as I was saying... A tournament where you bring a Rebel or Imperial list with that is 77 points, and then everyone gets to bid on in some way, shape, or form, or randomly lots drawn, Scum
that would be neat.
Mini lists
that would be neat.
That you add to your list.
That would
right?
be
That would be kind of fun. So you could end up with a couple six. You could end up with maybe not Fenrau. Fenrau's too expensive, which is good, right?
Right.
You'd end up with like a Palob or a whatever.
Well, cheaper ones.
Yeah, your cheaper things that add into your list. That could actually be really interesting, and maybe worth organizing. Actually, I'm gonna float that idea.
We could float
for
that one in PTL.
Yeah,
season.
for a game night maybe. Yeah. Not even for the whole season. Maybe just a postseason night or something like that. Like a little postseason mini tournament.
I'd be
or
game.
Something.
It'd be fun.
That could be fun.
And this really does open this up now. So we've got Rey versus Karner and Deathfire. Daniel, there will be four rounds and then a cut to top four, I believe. So
yeah,
another
two
more
rounds
after
that.
No, not super well, but
Ray
and Ark is nasty, and PS10.
Yeah, so Robert's saying 4-hull left for Ray and 8-hull left for Karnar and Deathfire total, but Ray hits like a truck and defends like a tank.
And is a turret.
And is a turret, right? So you can't arc dodge Ray, which is what Karnar wants to do, but can't do it.
This is going to be... Well, he's out of arc, so it doesn't really matter. And obstructed. Aaron's put himself in as good a position as he's going to get Karnar right
yeah.
now.
Yeah. So what do you do with Ray here? Do you sloop? I'm betting you sloop. Mara J... So someone here is proposing what a Mara J pilot would look like. If the defender is Luke Skywalker, you may... you may do all crits and yep. then receive some stress.
That sounds right.
That's pretty funny. But I doubt we'll ever see a ship that only works against one other specific ship. So we're
not
snooping. So it looks like Cam's going to bring Rey around here.
See, I think the thing he's going to run into now that's a bit of a problem is Aaron's ships are both facing the same way.
Mm-hmm.
He can pull Karnar around to his board edge and turn that bomber in and basically just pincer.
Get him from behind?
Yeah.
That's the thing. One of them will be able to get out of his arc, right? Unless Rey manages to get Karnar before Karnar... before the bomber gets around. So I would probably hard three. I would probably hard three with Ray, or hard two, I guess. And then Karnar's got to come around, so Karnar's going to hard two.
Hard two, be like a one forward next, and just...
But then you're in Ray's arc, and Ray just gets to defend like crazy with Finn and her abilities.
Right.
So that's a tough choice.
So, I still like my Jar Jar card. I've thought of that one. I would love to have a Jar Jar card where it's just roll a die on a blank or a focus, you die, and on a hit or a crit, they die. And it's just a 50-50. Because that's all that could ever happen. He would either screw something up and blow up your ship, or magic would happen.
There was something... Well, what was it? I saw on Reddit someone posted a Darth Jar Jar card. There's 23 minutes left in the match here. So each match is 75 minutes as standard. Oh, it looks like he's just running Karnar away.
Aaron's got him on points.
That's actually a good choice. Yeah, Aaron does have him on points. Can he run him out for 23 more minutes? I don't know about that.
No, he'd be able to run down the bomber.
But if Karnar lives, Aaron wins on points.
He still wins on points by two.
So,
ouch, that's rough.
So Rey needs to kill Karnar. And it's possible for Rey to...
That is not fun, though.
It's possible for Rey to get Karnar, to trap Karnar, that is.
It is.
Because, again, you can't arc dodge Rey. I mean, you can arc dodge Rey's good shot, but you can't arc dodge that turret entirely.
Yes, it is.
Yep, time is in the top right corner. Okay, so what do we do here? Another hard...
Ray will have to come in hard.
Hard three for Ray.
Hard two. Doesn't matter.
Hard two gives you more options for getting through the rocks on the next turn, I think.
And then maybe another hard turn, because I think Aaron's picked his direction, unless he's going to K-turn and do, like, a fake-out.
No, but even then, the Interceptor can, like, you know, hard two. So right where the Interceptor is right now,
he gets hard two
and barrel roll, yep. And then suddenly he's facing the other way again.
Yep.
Right? Actually, well, he's hard one, it looks like, here. Yeah, see, there you go. Now he's facing the other direction. So I'm hoping that Ray has done a hard two here and has them in arc. But the question is, the turn after that, where does Karnar go, right? Because Karnar could get out of Ray's arc easily
enough.
Well,
the big thing that I see is that Proxmine right now that Aaron dropped is not helping him.
It is actually getting in his way just a little bit.
That bomber, I think, does have bombs still. It should have one more prox mine.
Yep, extra munitions. He's only dropped the one prox mine, so there should be one more.
So it's not terrible, right? I mean, that bomber could drop. I mean, it is an uphill battle right now for Cam.
Just a one bank. One bank was actually really smart. Cam foresaw that Karnar might turn around, yep. And so now he's actually got... He's in a better position to... capture Karnar wherever he's going. Now, what would you do here with Ray? I might actually consider doing a one forward, right?
Sure. Put yourself right in front of a rock?
I'd be right in front of the rock, but then my arc is in a place where Karnar might not be able to get out of it. Right?
Yep.
You know what I mean? It's a tough choice.
This is tough.
If you one bank here, right? Like, it's the surprising move, right? So Cam could one bank and be in between these rocks in the center here. And sure, you'll get the bomber in arc, but that leaves Karnar the ability to get behind Ray. If Ray decides to just one forward, he could actually have Karnar in his sights.
Yeah.
If he's expecting Karnar to try and get behind him. So do the surprising thing. Sure, you'll go over the rock next turn, but sometimes doing that surprising thing might be the only option for you.
And he has very little options at this point.
Yeah, he has very
little
options.
I mean, he's got 4-hull.
Yeah.
Like, you're going to have to roll the dice and take some risks.
Now, the risk is landing on the rock.
Which would be not good.
But, I mean, I think you're going to... That's going to happen anyways. Not happen anyways, but...
Unless he's going to
You're going to die anyways, yeah.
Because Aaron, if I were him, I think I would try to turn towards the bottom of this map with Karnar.
Like to his left?
Yes.
Well, see, that's what I was thinking. You turn towards the left, assuming that Ray's going to bank in between these rocks.
And then I would do this with the bomber and turn in and just have two different sides and more or less keep somebody out of arc. And you're right, we are one forward, I think, would put both people in arc, which is what you need. Oh,
three forward. Interesting
gutsy
choice.
Oh, so gutsy. If he does a one bank, that would be...
Yeah, if he does a one bank, Karnar's in a really bad spot. But...
Boost.
Well, you barrel... No, can't fit.
Boost.
Cannot fit. You're not going the other way. You boost? Yeah.
Boost.
You bank boost, and you block Ray's move?
Yes.
But then Ray gets a perfect shot
yes,
at...
But Karnar is who he needs to keep alive.
True, true. So he keeps Karnar alive, but then Ray gets a perfect shot at the bomber. The bomber dies this turn.
Who has 5-hull, though?
Oh,
you might
not
be able to delete
bomber.
It. It's not going to be range 1.
But this also means Ray's not going to die this turn.
I think this is okay. Like this.
For who?
For
what is
Aaron
that?
Played
that
this
looks
about
like,
as well.
Yeah, there's the one bank. Yeah. So my idea of doing a one straight towards the rock would have been a very bad idea.
But risky. It would have been that high risk, high reward.
I mean, he'd still have the shot at at the bomber. And actually, he'd still have the range 1 turret shot at Karnar.
Yep. This is nice in
which might actually be
thrusters,
better.
Thrusters, though.
Yeah. Thrusters.
Can
still
push for focus.
Could be worth it.
It might be.
He can't focus here because Karnar's nearby.
Or no, I'm sorry, push. Like, for Karnar's actions, if you didn't.
So you might... Oh, well, you get no action anyways. So, c'est la vie. That's a range 3 shot at the bomber. Iris 25.
That's
so,
correct.
Ask the question, if you do a barrel roll and you can complete it in any way, you must do the action. Yes, that is true. But to the side that you declared, right? So Karnar here tried to barrel roll towards the rock. There was no way to complete it on that side. So he's not forced to barrel roll to the other side. He only has to choose to barrel roll to that side or not. Because that rock was in the way, there was no room for him to do barrel roll. He wasn't forced to go the other way. So barrel rolling left, barrel rolling right is different. If you can't make it, you can then choose to do something entirely different.
Ouch, blanking's not good.
That
was okay.
Are good. So
that was okay. Takes 1, I think, a crit.
So was that a crit? No, I think that was 2 hits. So Ray takes 1. Did the bomber take any?
No.
Doesn't look like it.
No.
That's really unfortunate.
To be fair, the frames on the...
frames are good. They're not
They're
great.
Not as good, but they're not terrible. Especially on a bomber where you've got plenty of hull.
Yeah.
Not terrible.
I mean, if you've got the points, there's no reason not to use them.
Now, the other thing here is... How does Cam not eat a bomb?
So, Iris... Oh, yeah. Ooh. So Iris says here that players have had him doing barrel rolls on the other side if he
no.
didn't do so. That's not the case. That is wrong. those players are wrong and bad people.
Yeah, that's not nice.
Not bad people. They probably just don't know themselves.
They could be bad people.
Yeah, they could be bad people. The same thing is also true of boosting. If you choose to boost in one direction, can't complete that particular boost, then you do not have to boost. You can do something else. You can focus or whatever else.
That's kind of what I was thinking, to be honest.
Oh, yeah.
3-4 drop a proxy? Yes, I agree, Robert. I would be going for a bomb here.
3-4 might hit that rock.
Just a 2-bank. Just something to basically cover up this back exit, because Cam's going to have to get out somehow. So as long as he can cut off that lane with another bomb.
A 2-bank actually would be a perfect opportunity. 2-bank, drop the proxy. It ends up right in the center there. And then where's Ray going? This is why I actually like, we've got Scavenger Crane on here with countermeasures and so on. One thing I actually like on Ray is, there it is, and there's the proxy. One thing I actually like on Ray is inertial dampeners. Because her thing is keeping people in arc. The ability to just stand still and be like, you were expecting me to move, now I'm not moving, you die now.
Yeah, it's very similar to your YV when you're playing scum with like a Bosk or something that.
Yeah.
You want to just sit there.
The ability to sit there once per game is worth it, easily. That being said, countermeasures is great. Scavenger Crane is great.
He could have Aaron will run.
So he didn't drop a proxy mine.
Oh. Why did he not do that?
That's a good question. He still has it. Does he forget that he has it? Or did he drop one before and we missed it?
No, we would have. I think we would have.
Well, the proxy is face down.
Oh. Did we miss a bomb getting dropped?
Oh, maybe he. We were talking about all sorts of stuff. He may have dropped one over here when the bombers were all still alive.
This could have been an announcer fail.
Yep. That might be our fault. It's possible, Robert, that he actually used the other proxy mine much earlier. Because it does look like he has the bomb card flipped down, which seems to me like he must have used it at some point. I don't know when, but I think we may have missed it. It may have been a situation where he dropped it and immediately went off, so it never actually stayed on the board.
Wow, that's nasty. Did he just put him onto a rock with a block and he eats a crit? Ouch. And even if he didn't land on that rock, he would have then be firing in at a range 3 against Karnar through a rock.
Oof. Yeah, that is not a good option.
Ouch. Hmm? I have no idea. It's down under where the... So damage sensor array is the...
Who's got damage sensor array?
Oh. I didn't take that crit out.
If he did have that proxy, there's no reason for him not to drop it there. So I'm pretty sure that he is out of the proxy mines. He must have dropped one earlier directly onto a ship. Maybe that's how he killed Kian. Again, we were too busy talking about fanciful tournament formats to actually be paying attention to the game.
I'm still happy with our decision.
Yeah, I'm happy with our decision. I hope you guys are happy with our decision. It's fun having these discussions. And I do want to try that hire a mercenary... tournament night. I think that would be a lot of fun.
So it looks like we're coming into about 12 minutes left in the round.
So what do you do? So if you're Ray, you sloop to the to board right, Ray's left, I guess. So that way you have Karnar in arc. You've got the bomber in arc as well. And you could take one of them, hopefully, off the board.
Yep.
That's a hard one. What is he?
He's going for a block on Karnar so then he can shoot.
So he's going to bump into the...
the bomber again.
Bomber. That's an interesting choice. So rather than take the range 3... So this is an interesting choice. Rather than take the range 3, it looks like he actually has Karnar in arc at range 2, which is where you want Karnar Jax to be. You're not going to get a focus because Karnar's around anyways. But now you can lay in 4 dice at Karnar Jax with Ray's rerolls. Ray and Finn So three dice plus fins blank plus all the rerolls. Two blanks, though, that's no good.
That is okay.
Hit and two crits against Karnor Jax, who rolls...
Oh, and Aaron's good.
Yep, he had an evade, he had a focus. I mean, that's the best shot you're going to get at Karnor all game.
Yeah.
This looks like it's probably going to be the end of Ray. Three dice from Karnor. Ray gets one plus a...
blank.
Blank and rerolls.
Ouch.
And that's good game.